Well, why don't we go ahead and get started? I know there's a lot of material to go through, but thank you all for joining our second education call of the year, a complement to our first on Dialysis 101. We're very excited to have members from the Christiana Care Health System Kidney Transplant Program on the line to go over the basics of Transplant 101. And when I say members of the team, it is definitely a full house over there. We have Claire and Aileen, who are both nurses and transplant coordinators, and also Dr. Scantlebury, a transplant surgeon, available to present information and answer questions when the time comes. So without further ado, if you ladies are ready, please feel free to take it away.
Thank you, Christy. We appreciate you having us to talk to the patients. We just want to let you know we are in a pretty large conference area with some doors and such in the background, so there may be a little bit of background noise. We've spoken to them and asked them to try to keep that to a minimum, but please let us know if there's any trouble hearing.
Definitely.
Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about transplant. My objectives that I'm going to speak about right now are listed there. We're going to talk a little bit about what makes a person a candidate for transplant, to explain why everyone is, some people may not be a candidate, and then also to provide information about what patients can do to be listed for transplant and how they can remain listed. We'll also talk a little bit about how the list works. Sorry. There is some criteria to be listed, and this is the same at all transplant centers. You either need to be on either mode of dialysis, so it would be hemodialysis or peritoneal. And if you're not on dialysis, your estimated glomerular filtration rate, which is your kidney function number, needs to be at 20% or below. There are some things that they call contraindications for listing, and this used to be known as exclusion criteria. It means that if you have these issues, you're not a candidate for transplant. These include severe heart disease that has no possibility of intervention. If you have heart disease and something can be done about it and it can be treated and it's safe for you to be transplanted, that's a different story. If you have another organ failure that requires transplant, you can be referred to a center that does combine transplant. If you do have irreversible essential organ failure of another sort, that would rule you out. Actually, active current malignancy, that means active cancer, or multiple medical problems that make surgery unsafe for you. In addition, there's some possible contraindications for listing. That means that these things vary from individuals, and you would need to be looked at individually with your personal, you know, health information. Age would be one. It depends upon what center you go to, what the age cutoff would be. If you have significant blood vessel disease, this is important because kidney transplant surgery is a blood vessel surgery. Patients who cannot care for themselves after a transplant and they don't have a support person to help them, that can affect whether you would be a candidate. Body mass index or BMI, weight is variable according to center, but it's important for a patient to be relatively fit. Patients with no means to financially pay for post-transplant medications, this is really important because you need to be able to have those medications to keep your kidney well. This is also, I can't read the top thing, so please excuse me. Other possible contraindications for listing would be people who use active illegal drugs or they have other psychosocial contraindications. In some situations, programs can refer you to rehabilitation centers and help patients in that situation get assistance. But it is a possible contraindication. Patients who have cancers that have been past treated, either medically or surgically, it just depends upon the case, but it is a possible contraindication. If you have recurrent infections or there's issues getting it treated, that is also tobacco abuse. That's a big one, and that's either smoking or chewing tobacco. Untreated sleep apnea or CPAP noncompliance. If you have sleep apnea and it's not being treated appropriately, it can prevent your kidney from being properly oxygenated. So that's important and is a possible contraindication. And if you're HIV positive, that is a possible contraindication. Lost my arrow. Sorry, we're just having a little bit of computer problems over here. Just bear with us, please. There it is. We can either see the arrow or we just can't see the top part of the slide. There we go. So there's a lot of testing that needs to be completed before you're actually, it's been decided that you are a candidate to be listed for kidney transplant. And this is important to know because kidney transplant is not a life-saving procedure. It's actually elective surgery. So we need to be sure that you're safe to have the surgery done. And also because post-transplant medications that keep patients from rejecting their kidney, this immunosuppressive medication, makes it easier for patients to develop cancers, infections, and viruses. So we need to be sure that you're free of these conditions prior to being in that situation where you're receiving those medications. Also, as we spoke of before about blood vessels, kidney transplant surgery is a blood vessel surgery. So it's important that we have appropriate testing like CAT scans of your abdomen and pelvis, ultrasounds of that region as well, so that the surgeons are able to assess whether your blood vessels are healthy enough to have this procedure done. So we talked about different tests. So this is some ideas of what centers would require for you to have done to be considered to be listed for kidney transplant. Cardiac testing is something that you have to do for the majority of surgeries that you would have to have to be sure that you're well enough and your heart can tolerate the surgery, and it decreases the risk of adverse events during or afterwards. During your evaluation, when you would come in to be considered for listing, you would get cardiac testing done. And then once a year, annually, while you are listed. In addition, there's different types of blood work. We test for many different things to see if you've been exposed to TB, to see how your clotting factors are. We test your HLA, kind of seeing what antibodies that you have and what you're made of. Viral testing to see what you've been exposed to see how you'll have to be treated for those conditions after you've been transplanted. Also radiology. I talked a little bit about those blood vessels. That's what we talked about, the CAT scan and the abdomen and or an ultrasound. The surgeons are going to use this to look at your anatomy, and it'll also be used to make sure you don't have any cancerous processes going on in those areas. In addition, a chest x-ray, and that's going to look at your chest area. It's going to rule out any infections you may have in your lungs, any cancerous processes to be concerned about that you can see with that study, and also heart and other heart and lung issues. In addition, this is really important for patients who are considering coming in to be listed for transplant or coming in for an evaluation. Health maintenance. These are things that you can be doing while you're thinking about coming in for evaluation or you're considering, you're actually waiting for your appointment. These are things that you should be doing for yourself anyway to make sure your health is appropriate. Mammograms for women over 40, I think it's changed now. I think that the guideline says over 45 if you don't have a familial history of breast cancer. GYM and pap exams for women of all ages, and this just depends upon how often your gynecologist says that you need these tests. Colonoscopy for everyone who's over 50, and then dental clearance, and this rules out infection and cancers that you may have in your mouth. And as we said, these medications that you'll be taking once you receive a kidney transplant make it easier for you to get infections and have cancers grow, so it's important for us to know exactly what your health care is. In addition, other testing may be ordered based on what your personal health history is. The doctors will review your medical records that you provided for us and the dialysis center's records before you come in. And then when they're going to do a physical examination, they may see something that is of concern, and they'd like to know a little bit more about it. So there could be varied testing ordered. So We talk about different members of our team, the coordinators, the surgeons, our transplant nephrologists, but the most important member of our team is you, the patient. And that's because you need to be involved in your care to be able to get to a place where you can be evaluated, to where you've got your testing done and you can be discussed for listing. And it's important that you keep in contact with the transplant center that you're working with to let them know what your current state of health is and any changes in your phone numbers, contact information, or insurance. We're going to talk a little bit about kidney transplant, about listing. So why is there a wait list for kidney transplant from a deceased donor? These numbers are pretty amazing, and it'll let you know why. So over 500,000 people in the United States have chronic kidney disease. And out of this 500,000 people, over 100,000 of them are on the kidney transplant waiting list. And it increases every day as patients are interested in coming in and being evaluated and getting listed. And out of those, over 100,000 people, only 15,000 kidney transplants are done in the United States every year. That's really, it's amazing. And then out of that, half of those are from living donors. So only about 50% of that, between 7,000 and 8,000 kidney transplants are done from a deceased donor kidneys. It's kind of amazing. That's a lot of people. So once you're listed, I'm sure you want to know how organs are offered and how we, you know, find out who's going to get the kidney. So there's a list that's generated for each kidney offered by the United Network of Organ Sharing. That's our nationwide organization that holds the list of all potential recipients. The United Network of Organ Sharing then notifies the Organ Procurement Organization, or the OPO, and ours in our area is Gift of Life, if you're in this area. And they let them know that there's a kidney available. So someone at the center then, which is our surgeons or one of our providers, reviews the information about the donor to make sure that it's an appropriate offer and if the kidney is a good fit for the recipient. And after that point, the patient is notified by a coordinator at the hospital where they are listed. So you would receive a phone call that a potential kidney could be available for you. God, it's okay. Okay. I hate how this is not working for you, but there's not really anything to do about it. So there's an option to do what they call multi-list. So basically you're listed at two different centers. So what happens is, as I talked about, an organ procurement organization. Our local one is Gift of Life. It covers Delaware, southern New Jersey, and eastern Pennsylvania. So there's an option that you could list at a different OPO, say one located in Maryland. So there's an advantage to be listed in two, because it's going to increase your chances to match with a donor. And it can decrease your wait time because you've got two different donor pools that you may be getting offers for. There are disadvantages to this for the recipient, though, at times, because you must travel to the area where the kidney is transplanted. So you're going to have to go to Maryland or go to a transplant center, maybe out of your area if you get an offer from that, to get the actual surgery and then also receive all of your follow-up care. Now, once you've gone through your evaluation process and the transplant center that you're working with decides that you're eligible to be listed, there's different listing statuses. The first one we're going to talk about is a status 7. This is when you're listed inactively. So you're listed for transplant, and you're accumulating time on the deceased donor list, but you won't be called with an organ offer. And there's different reasons why patients may be listed as status 7. Sometimes you're actively listed, and you may have a change in your functional status. If you have a heart stent, you're receiving, it may be a drug-eluting stent where you're receiving anticoagulation, and you're not able to receive transplant for 1 year after that procedure. Sometimes you just may have a change in your health. You may not be well enough, or maybe a change in your social status where you don't have that support person to help you. Basically, this status is if you're temporarily unable to receive a kidney. But the goal for anyone who is waiting to be transplanted or an evaluation patient is to be listed as a status one. This means that you're actively listed. We're talking about the importance of having your testing completed. It means your tests are completed, they're current, you're ready from every aspect, medical, surgical, psychosocial, to be offered this kidney. This is, should be your goal as a recipient and then our goal as a transplant center. So there's no such thing as top of the list. Even the waiting time does factor into how quickly you'll be receiving a transplant once you're listed. It's not just based on that information anymore, like the person with the longest wait time. The order of the list changes with every organ that becomes available. This is because of donor blood type is taken into consideration, whether you're cross-matched with the donor and you're actually compatible. The time that you have on the list is taken into consideration, but also the recipient's state of health at the time. That's really one of the reasons why it's so important that you have all of your current health care information updated and you're staying as healthy as possible. And it's also based on the KDPI of the donor. It's called the Kidney Donor Profile Index. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what that means. And actually, the United Network of Organ Sharing is the group that makes the ultimate decision of who is getting an organ. It's not done by the transplant center.
Oh, no. It's yours, too.
Okay. We're going to talk a little bit about living donation now. There's different types of donors. If you're waiting on the list, the type of kidney that you would receive would be from a deceased donor from listed, but there's also something called living donation, and we're going to talk a little bit about that, and also the types of deceased donors as well. Now, there's a list, and it's a little bit busy here, but we're going to move forward because we're going to talk about these donors on the following slides. The first that we're going to talk about is living donors. Living donation, you can have different types of donors if you're having a living donation. It can be related or unrelated. There is criteria, and that might depend upon what center you go to, but usually it's somewhere between 18 and 65 years old. The living donor, of course, must be healthy, and they must be willing and want to donate an organ to you, a kidney, and you must be compatible with their blood type. The advantages for living donation, and the biggest one, as you can see, you don't have to wait on a list. You're not one of the, waiting with those over 100,000 people. There's a shorter time, too, between the kidney removal and transplantation. Basically, there's a surgeon removing a kidney in one operating room across the hallway sometimes, and then you're in the operating room just waiting for that to be put in. So there's minimal on-ice time for transplant. It's also a planned surgery. So you get better outcomes. It's not happening in the middle of the night. And the kidney is coming from a live person who is well. That's one of the most important things. This is someone who's been screened. We know they're healthy, and that kidney is going to be coming from that person, not from a deceased donor. There's an evaluation for living donors, too. So if you have a living donor, we'll talk a little bit about how they can prepare for this. It's kind of close to what the recipient has to do during their evaluation. So there's going to be different coordinators. As we said, Aline and I are both transplant coordinators, but we work with recipients. There are living donor coordinators who just work with living donors and living donation. They'll do a history and a physical to rule out health issues that make it unsafe for donors or for the recipient. And there's going to be blood and tissue typing done. So that's some lab work to check for compatibility between the recipient and the living donor. And there'll be testing order, basically very similar to what the testing is for recipients, to make sure that it's safe for them and they're healthy enough. Oh, Okay, so the evaluation is going to be very similar to an evaluation that's done for a recipient when they come into a transplant center. They're going to be seen by a transplant team. It's going to include the nephrologist, the surgeon, that living donor nurse coordinator, social worker, dietitian, an independent donor advocate, and then other members of the team as necessary. The surgery is covered by the recipient's insurance, but I'm not sure about all programs, but I know that our program asks that the donor have medical insurance. Just that way, just so that if there is something that's found during the workup or something may happen post-transplant, they're able to receive the necessary health care. There also is travel assistance that could be possibly available for a donor. So your donor does not have to be local, and this assistance is available through the National Living Donor Assistance Fund. So living donation can be challenging but very fulfilling. If you listen to stories from living donors, it's quite amazing. They found it's been one of the best things you hear them, that they've done in their lives. Timing of donation is determined by the donor. So it'd be when to their availability because they're going to be the ones giving their kidney up. And the transplant team can't share information about the donor with you. It's because it's private health care information. So if a donor just gets turned down for a medical condition or if they decide not to go forward with donation, that wouldn't be information that's to be shared with the recipient. That would be something that would have to be discussed directly with the donor. So if you have a living donor, as I said, there's things that you can do or they can be working on while you're getting worked up, you're considering evaluation, you're waiting to be listed. Anyone who wants to be should start getting their health care updated. It's a lot like the things that we talked about with general health care for anyone. Mammograms as appropriate, GYN and pap screens for women, colonoscopy for everyone over 50. We recommend that they have their vaccinations done and just that they see their primary care physician. So that way they're able to be treated for any conditions they have. There's also another option. If you have a living donor and you're not compatible by blood type, there's another way you can receive a kidney if your donor doesn't match you. So both you and your donor would be entered into what they call a paired donation program if you decide that's what you would want to do and your donor agrees to do it. There's National Kidney Registry is one of the programs that we work with, but there's other programs out there. And what happens is you receive a kidney from someone who's compatible with you, and then your donor would give up a kidney to someone who is compatible with them. Now, we talked a little bit about living donation here. We're going to talk about a little bit about deceased donors. I mentioned KDPI in a previous slide. It's a kidney donor profile index. It's a number that's given to a donor based on a lot of information. It takes into consideration their age, health conditions like hypertension, diabetes, if their cause of death was by stroke, their height and their weight, whether it was a donation after cardiac death. We're going to talk a little bit about that, so I will define that for you. Their race and their ethnicity, and then their hepatitis C status. And usually hepatitis C donors usually donate to hepatitis C recipients, but that depends upon your program. There's different categories, and this has to do with how the kidneys are actually allocated. If the kidney donor profile index is less than 20, those are given to those with the longest expected post-transplant survival. Between 20 and 35, usually pediatrics first, and then according to wait time. And as you can see, 35 to 85, they're allocated for wait time, and greater than 85 is given to those who accept kidney offers from an older donor who may have had some health problems. And they say KDPI greater than 85. These kidneys are maybe considered, quote unquote, not quite ideal, and there is a separate wait list for recipients who sign a consent to consider those type of offers. And as you, any offer can be accepted or turned down. Kidney survival rate is lower than if somebody had a KDPI that was in the 20s, or teens, 30s. But if you're over 40, your survival rate is better with this type of donor than if you stay on dialysis, if you're medically appropriate for transplant. There's also something called donation after cardiac death. The donors we were talking about previously, we would say those are brain dead donors, not the living donors, but the KDPI. This is a little bit different because this donor fails to meet criteria for brain death. So in order for the donor to be declared deceased, their heart must stop beating. So they're removed from life support before the kidneys are removed for transplant. So the only issue that you see here is about 40% chance of what they call a delayed graft function. That's a sleepy kidney. But the kidneys recover. But you may need dialysis for a short time if you receive this type of kidney transplant. There's also another option for people who are looking to be transplanted. It's something called directed donation. If someone dies in a hospital under a certain condition, and their family is aware that a recipient is on a list, they can actually ask that you be given that kidney. This works if the donor and the recipient are compatible because it's being directly donated to the recipient. And the kidney can come from anywhere, not just in our area, any place in the United States. There's also another type of donor. It's called a public health services high-risk donor. And as you know, with blood and organs, all donors are tested for HIV and hepatitis before you're called with an organ offer. So organs coming from donors that meet criteria of the public health services as high risk are considered high risk donors. And you can see the list that would have a donor meet this criteria be sexual behaviors, drug use, out of the country travel, tattoos and body piercings, imprisonment, and greater than 10 blood transfusions. And of course you would be told if your kidneys were coming from a high risk donor. They would let you know, and you would have an option, of course, to accept or decline any offer that's given to you.
Okay.
Dr. Scannelberry's taking over now.
This is Dr. Scannelberry. I'm going to talk about the transplant surgery and also complications after you undergo a transplant, either deceased or living donor. So in terms of the kidney transplant operation, basically the kidney is placed either on the right or left side and lower part of your abdomen. And the reason for this is that we really want to be able to connect the kidney to your blood vessels as they enter, just before they enter into your leg. And this is because your bladder, which sits right over under your pubic bone, you want to be able to connect the drainage tube of the kidney called the ureter back into your own bladder so that as the kidney makes urine, it's secreted into your bladder and we're able to monitor that urine output via Foley catheter. So for patients getting a kidney transplant, depending on the surgeon, either right-handed or left-handed or the kidney itself, first kidney will go on one side. If they're having a second kidney transplant, it will go on the other side. And so that's usually where it's placed. In terms of surgery, generally with patients, the potential issues are usually bleeding. So a lot of our patients are patients who are on dialysis or uremic. You can have uremic bleeding just because you have abnormal platelet function. And so we're usually trying to make sure that we are careful about the amount of blood loss. It's not a whole lot of blood loss. We do take extra time to make sure that we correct any bleeding that is occurring. We use antibiotics to prevent infection. All of patients receive IV antibiotics preoperatively and intraoperatively, and we do that in order to prevent infections. It's also important when you come in to make sure that you don't have any infections either on your skin or bladder infections that could potentially contribute to an infection post-transplant surgery. Sometimes the kidneys will will seep what's called serous fluid or lymph fluid that can collect around the kidney from the lymphatics that are attached from the kidney itself. And so oftentimes if we really are concerned about fluid collecting around the kidney or lymphocytes, we will put a drain in the patient's at the time of surgery to be removed after surgery or after a few days once you make sure that there's not a lot of drainage from the drainage catheter that's placed. Not all kidneys will function right away after transplant. Our goal is to be able to determine kidneys that are not suitable for transplant, but oftentimes, as we said before, if it's a donation after cardiac death, we may not have function of that kidney within the immediate time. During that time, the patient would be dialyzed, but the goal is that less than 1% of the time, despite what we do and the information is given to us, very rare, but we can have a kidney that just never opens up and never function at all. But that's the goal, is to prevent that sort of thing. Clotting issues, we really want to establish before a patient is undergoes surgery whether they have issues with abnormal clotting so that they're not predisposed to clotting the kidney. But occasionally, very rare again, we can have patients who thrombose their kidney because of issues with clotting. But again, part of the workup is to be able to have more information about these things and be able to know if that's an issue. In some patients who come to us with a history of having issues with clotting, we may keep them on their blood thinners, whether they're on heparin or Coumadin or other agents, and we will perform the surgery with them on Coumadin or warfarin, just to avoid issues with clotting or thrombosis. Urinary leak or blockage, this can be one of the complications we see after surgery, and part of it is that that ureter is connected to your bladder, and part of the issues we may see may be not enough blood supply to that drainage tube or ureter as it's connected to your bladder. We may have issues with the bladder not being in good shape. Maybe the patient had not made urine for a while, but oftentimes we will make sure that we will follow the patient to see if there's any urine collecting outside the bladder around the kidney, and this can often be corrected. What happens after the transplant? Basically, your time in the hospital is to make sure that you're able to tolerate the anti-rejection medicine, which are started usually before you go into the operating room, and then during the operating room, you're given intravenous anti-rejection medicine, and then post-transplant, once you return to the floor, we start these medications by mouth as soon as you're able to tolerate them. And the goal post-transplant is really to make sure that you're able to get out of bed, tolerate your pain, able to eat, and that your nausea and vomiting passes after the surgery, and that you can move around and be ready for discharge. So there's no prolonged stay. Generally, it's about 3 to 5 days with the living donors because they generally have immediate function of the transplant. And so we can see an immediate improvement in the creatinine, and we plan for discharge as soon as they complete their course of intravenous anti-rejection medicine, which is about 4 days. And from there, we are able to discharge the patient. With some patients with deceased transplant, the kidney may be somewhat slower in waking up, and so there may be a few extra days in terms of length of stay to decide on medication adjustments, determine blood pressure management, and also the plan for discharge home in terms of with family and support. The anti-rejection medicines are started immediately prior to transplant and after transplant. The goal is to continue these medications for the life of the kidney, as long as that kidney is there, to keep your body from rejecting that kidney, because the goal is that that kidney is going to be viewed by your body as something foreign. And as long as that kidney is there, your body is at risk for rejecting it. And so the goal is to be able to use these medications on a daily basis to do our best to prevent rejection. And that's why it's so important to be monitored and to have regular blood work. when you miss doses of your anti-rejection medicine, you open up the possibility that your kidney surveillance mechanism will see this kidney in the absence of its medication, and you are set up for rejection when that happens. So the goal really is that we immediately post-transplant, you're seen in clinic at least twice a week, and blood work twice a week to regulate improvement in your kidney function and also to regulate your anti-rejection medicines and the dose of those medications.
That's me.
Okay, next up is Aileen, our nurse manager.
I see there's a message on here, a question from Christy, from Retta. RO stands for rule out. Okay. So I'm going to talk a little bit, oh, I'm sorry. I'm going to talk about the dream of transplant and what's real about transplant. Most people, when you ask them, why do you want to get transplanted, they say, well, I want my life to be different. I want to be able to do things that I can't do now. And that's realistic, that you want to do things that you can't do now. But it doesn't necessarily mean that if you can't walk, we're going to be able to make you walk, or that if you don't breathe well, that we're going to make your COPD go away. It is not a miracle treatment. It is a treatment for kidney failure that does involve follow-up care. So again, it's a treatment. It's not a cure. It's just a treatment. And a lot of people are a little disillusioned about it when they find out how much work it is after transplant, because they have to take medications, they have to come in for frequent medical care, there's hospitalization sometimes, and lots of lab work. So after transplant, as Dr. Scannelberry already said, you're going to come into the office twice a week until we can get you established to make sure that your medications are the right dose, that you are not rejecting your kidney, but also not so strong that you get every little germ that goes down the pike. We want you to be able to go out with your family, go to church, and do those kinds of things that bring you pleasure without getting sick every time you walk out the door. So it's a very fine balance between giving you enough medication to keep you from rejecting the kidney and from getting sick all the time. Rejection, you don't feel. So therefore, we have to go by lab work. So there is a lot of lab work that has to be done also to make sure that we are on the right track with the medications. At some point, it kind of evens out so that you don't need to have lab work as often. Different things can change that maybe will make you need more or less. But for the most part, eventually you'll stabilize on it. We provide continued care from the transplant team for the life of your kidney, and most transplant centers do that. They may send you back to see your primary nephrologist because it's easier for you to see them locally. But all in all, we are responsible, so any place that you would be visiting, if they have any questions, like if you decided to go on a trip to Indiana and you got sick there, they have... we are available to answer questions about your immunosuppressives or anything like that. And it's extremely important that you stay in contact with your transplant team. I don't have statistics right in front of me, but they have shown that this is one of the main reasons that people lose their kidneys is when they quit being involved with their transplant team. So after transplant, you can be on anywhere from 20 to 30 pills a day. We're going to be adding a couple new medications to you, the anti-rejection medicines, which are Prograf and Celcept. And sometimes you may need steroids for a short dosage. But the Prograf and Celcept are usually taken, the Prograf is usually taken twice a day. The Celcept can be taken anywhere from twice to four times a day. And those medications are what you need to take in order to keep your body from recognizing that that kidney doesn't belong to you. In addition to that, there's also another there is another medication called Nalogix that you take instead of the Prograf, and it's a monthly infusion. Some of the medications you're going to be taking after transplant are also there to help you get through the very vulnerable stage that you might be in, which is the stage where you might be a little over immunosuppressed, like right after surgery, you've gotten immunosuppression before you've gotten your kidney transplant, and then you go home on a dose that we are manipulating and working with all the time. So sometimes that can make you a little bit too immunosuppressed. So we have to give you medications to kind of fight bacterial infections like urinary tract infections and pneumonias. We put you on an antiviral, too, to keep you from getting a flare-up of those viruses that we know you've been exposed to. And for a short time, we put you on an antifungal to keep you actually from getting something called thrush. You've probably heard about that with babies. And that frequently occurs in your mouth. You'll continue on the same medications that you're on right now. So whatever you're taking for blood pressure medicine, you'll still need to take blood pressure medicine. You'll still need to take your cholesterol medicine, your diabetic medicine, and sometimes you may even need to still get EPO shots to treat your anemia for a short period of time. There's lots of side effects to the medications. We do work very hard to help either distribute the doses differently or give you some anti-nausea medicine or some anti-diarrhea medicine. Some of the medications may cause low blood counts, and you may have to get injections for that. Diabetes can occur from the medications, and that's why in the hospital we start diabetic teaching. Now, a lot of patients that were diabetic and then they've been on dialysis for a while, and all of a sudden they stop needing insulin, they think, oh, my diabetes is cured. Your diabetes is not cured. What has happened is the small amounts of insulin that are being made by your body are not being excreted in the urine. So it's keeping the insulin in, and therefore you may not need any supplemental insulin. But once you start urinating again, you're going to start urinating out that insulin. So that can also bring back diabetes. If you've already been a diabetic, you're going to stay a diabetic. Infections can happen, and with infections, it can be anywhere from urinary tract infections to pneumonia. These infections can hit you a little bit harder than they would somebody who is not immunosuppressed. The idea of giving you the medicines are not to give you enough to make you get illnesses, but also to give you enough that you don't reject your kidney. Some of the other side effects are hair loss, increased blood pressures, and cancers can grow more quickly, which is why we put our patients through such a workup to start with. We have to make sure that there's no, as far as we can tell, that there are no cancers in you before we start giving you immunosuppressive drugs. Now, the common reasons that kidneys stop working is that patients die naturally. Anywhere from you could have a car accident and your kidney's still working, or you could have a heart attack or a stroke, the kidney is still working. Infections and cancers can be another reason, but missing medications is the one thing that you really have control over that can lead to rejection. If you miss your medicines, you will reject your kidney. And so therefore, and everyone comes in saying, oh, I want this kidney transplant so bad, I will never miss my medications. But then you get involved in life and you're out somewhere and you get caught at your child's house in a snowstorm and you forgot to take an extra dose of medication with you and you end up missing a dose. So you have to plan ahead when you're going out. You always have extra dose of medications with you, so that you don't lose or miss a dose. The main reasons that patients are admitted to the hospital after transplant are for dehydration. I know that that's a hard thing for dialysis patients to understand because you're on a fluid restriction right now, but after transplant, we will really encourage you to drink more fluids in most cases. And in the summertime especially, our patients, we have to call them and remind them to drink more. Your creatinine's going up. You need to drink more fluid. Again, this is for people who've been post-transplant and not patients who are on dialysis right now. And also, the older you are, the more susceptible you're going to be to dehydration and infections. And that's the most common cause of death in our older patients is dehydration and infections. Skin cancers occur more commonly in patients that are immunosuppressed. The most common cancer is skin cancer. It occurs in 50% of patients who are transplanted by 5 years and 80% by 10 years. A lot of these cancers are either basal cell or squamous cell, and they are fairly easily treated, but there's also a chance of melanoma, which is not. We do ask that everyone wear sunscreen. So again, this can be a change maybe in how you live now. We want you to use sunscreen when you're outside and protect your skin. Cancer can develop more often in your native kidneys, the kidneys you were born with. The longer you're on dialysis, the more chance you have of growing cysts in your kidney. Not just people with polycystic kidney disease, but patients who are on dialysis, their kidneys start to grow cysts, and this is called acquired cystic disease. And oftentimes, these cysts won't matter at all to you while you're on dialysis, but when we give you a transplant and give you immunosuppressive drugs, then cancers can develop in your native kidneys, and then they'd have to be removed. There's also a specific cancer called post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorder. It only occurs in about 1% of the population, and it's caused by the Epstein-Barr virus or the mononucleosis virus. We do monitor for this to make sure that you don't get this, and so we can give you treatment right away for it. Another problem, which Claire and Dr. Scantlebury both mentioned, is delayed graft function. The kidneys go through a lot of trauma. Obviously, with living donation, they don't go through as much trauma. But they do go through trauma when they're removed from one person, and then they're flushed and cleaned, and the fat's cut off of them, and then they're put in a bucket of ice, and then they get transferred from some sort of a distance. We don't always know how far they come. And so they are a little bit hurt during the whole process. And even though they're working really well on the deceased donor, when we get them, they might be a little sluggish. They don't want to work right away. And that's called delayed graft function, which means you may need to have dialysis for a short period of time. The one thing most people who've heard about transplant fear the most is rejection. And rejection does not always mean you're going to lose your kidney. Rejection does not mean you're going to lose your kidney. We do what's called, biopsies ahead of time. Just to make sure that we're on the right track with your medications. And again, like I mentioned earlier, you don't feel rejection necessarily. This is our last slide. So if you have any further information about kidney transplant or to make an appointment at Christiana Care for a kidney transplant, call this number. Oh, and I forgot to add our website. Now, any questions? I think we have 10 minutes for questions.
I don't know if you were able to see, but on chat, Red had another question about leeway in taking your medications. For example, like she currently has a schedule 6 a.m. and 6 p.m., but sometimes can't take pills till 7. Is that going to make a big difference?
Oh, generally, we try to say within an hour is pretty good. It's where we want you to be. Granted, the goal is that you don't want to vary too much on your dose and medication. If you find that you're off by an hour, it may help to just change your timing to make it suitable for you so that you really, because we're measuring a trough when you come in for your blood work. So the goal really is to try to get your body used to the cycle of the medication 12 hours apart and try to stick to that. If we say 8 and 8 for your timing and that turns out to be too late or too early, you can readjust your timing to 9 and 9 or 7 and 7. Just make sure that on the day of your lab work, that you not take your medicine. I'll try to have your blood work drawn an hour before your medication is due. So for instance, if you work at night and you decide that you're going to take your medicine at 11 a.m. and 11 p.m., then it becomes important that when you come into the lab that you get to the lab around 10 as opposed to 7 or 8 in the morning, because then that's not really going to be a trial for us. And that's when we like to see measure the dose of the medication in your system.
And Julie, do you have a question? I saw that you raised your hand. Your microphone should be active. Maybe Julie temporarily stepped away. If there are any other questions, of course, please push #6 to unmute your line.
Christy, this is Nancy Scott. I don't have a question, but I would like to thank Dr. Scannelberry and the team on behalf of the Education Center for this presentation today. It's getting better and better, and I'm kind of biased because, of course, Dr. Scannelberry did my transplant, and it'll be 5 years in May. So I just wanted to really thank them for coming.
Well, thank you. We'll expect a check in the mail.
And Nancy, I hear you're still doing wonderful things with our government.
Well, I don't know about that. I'm doing the best I can for the organization. Eileen, the nurse manager, she's seen me at my worst and at my best. And in fact, she started with me with my first day of dialysis, and I was not a great patient. I was compliant, but I complained a lot. But I've come a long way, and I do recommend a transplant. As she said, it's not a cure. It's just another remedy. But it beats sitting in a chair 3 times a week when it only takes a couple of minutes to take a pill. And whether you take 3 or 20, it's worth it because it's a lot of freedom of life. I travel a lot, so I don't have to plan ahead for a dialysis seat or none of that, so you're not as confined. So if you're on the fence about making a decision to have a transplant, I recommend it wholeheartedly, and to talk to other people who have had this experience, and I'm sure that most of them will tell you the same thing.
Well, thank you.
That's awesome.
Thank you so much. We appreciate it, and I hope everyone on the line was able to learn something a little bit more from this presentation, and feel free to contact us with any questions or delayed questions that may pop up in your mind. Also, you know, you guys are doing what we need done, which is continue with education to the community.
Thank you so much again, echoing Nancy's statements. It was a great call. And I think we got Julie back. Julie, did you have a question or a comment before we conclude today?
Yeah, can you hear me okay now?
Yep.
Yes. Oh, great. Okay, I've had 3 transplants. So in the past, you didn't mention prednisone when you were going over the meds. Is that still the case?
Say that again.
No, it's not a mistake. We don't always use prednisone in our program, but I'll let Dr. Scannelberry answer that. She's had 3 prior transplants.
Well, generally with patients with a prior transplant, depends on how long you've been on prednisone and in terms of years, because even if we have a prednisone-free protocol and you have been on prednisone for more than a few years, generally we worry about whether your adrenals are burnt out and you may not be able to make that baseline prednisone that your body secretes on a regular basis, and it may mean that you may need to continue on prednisone because it's been such a long time already on prednisone from your previous transplant.
That would have been nice to know. I've now been on prednisone for like probably 20 years.
Oh, right, right. So for patients with long-term prednisone, they're usually not able to come off of prednisone.
Yeah, the only thing that I think, because I don't have any side effects, thank goodness, but the one thing I've learned over the years, if you're on prednisone, you still need to watch your sodium intake. a lot. Because
correct.
When you have that sodium along with the prednisone, you are going to retain fluid like crazy.
And sometimes we may start out not on a prednisone protocol, but if you have rejection more than once, mm-hmm. even if it's just mild and we have to treat it with steroids and it responds, we will then continue that patient on a small dose baseline, so that then gets added to their regimen.
Yeah, for my third transplant, I was on a very low dose. They didn't, you know, put me for like 60 milligrams like they had done like 20 years prior. So
correct. Things have changed.
And one thing that I've been asked by other patients, we have a patient here who's going through the transplant workup, and, you know, one of the main things is dental care, where you have to have all your teeth, you know, healthy. We can't pay for the dental care. And that's one issue that we're running into here. Okay,
you know,
I've been asked about.
The thing about the dental care is that it is very expensive. It's very hard to get dental care. It's not covered by Medicaid or Medicare, et cetera. And so
right.
everyone lets that go. Well, you know, with renal disease, you already have a problem with loss of bone mass, and your teeth are not as good or as strong because of the calcium phosphorus imbalances that the patients have. But you're
right.
going to die if you don't, if you get transplanted and are immunosuppressed and you have a mouthful of rotted teeth, broken off teeth, or teeth that are gums that are infected, then the thing of it is that you could actually die from the immunosuppression. You could also get endocarditis and meningitis,
mm-hmm.
which is also another problem. So mm-hmm. although we feel very bad about the dental care, but we're looking at the long-term effects and trying to keep our patients safe. Now, we do have some assistance here that if
that's what my question was basically, yeah, if you have any assistance.
If there is someone who is in need, we do have some funding that we've collected and that's managed that they can talk to the social worker about. And we have helped quite a few people get their dental work through this dental assistance fund. But the patients have to tell us that they can't do it, just not ignore us when we say you need to get your dental done, and then they don't say, well, I really, really, really need help with it. Now, it is a pretty stringent criteria, so it's not going to be for everybody.
Yeah, the goal really is to prevent the risk of infection. So if you have a lot of rotten teeth or mold, the things that what need to be removed to decrease your risk of getting a post-transplant infection. We're not going to pay to have dentures placed or to have bridges or stuff like that placed, but we just want to get the patient to the point where their infection risk is minimal to none.
Yeah, we don't care if their teeth look pretty. We just don't want them to be infected or have any mouth cancers. And that's
absolutely.
Even with some of the dentists, we've had trouble with this. They'll send us a letter saying that somebody needs, you know, $5,000 worth of dental care. Well, no, they don't need, not for transplant, they don't. They need to have their dental caries filled or their rotten teeth removed so that there's no infection. So, and unfortunately, you know, there's only the clinics to go to, and even with them, there is no free dental care in Delaware unless you're a child. There is some for patients over 65, and there is some for people who are diabetic.
I'm in Utah, but awesome. I will definitely share that with our patients there.
And there's also, like Galene said, there's programs that are based on your income. So there are some programs like, I know there's a program at Wilmington Hospital. They have a dental clinic. There is sometimes quite a bit of weight. But we try to make referrals for our patients who come in who are being evaluated or who are listed who need dental care. And then if their patients are coming from downstate, there's also some programs down there as well who can we'll take into consideration, financial ability to pay and try to make some adjustments on cost.
And also, she's in Utah, so it might be very limited because she's our newest board member, and she's in Utah. And I know in Delaware they have a kidney fund too. But what you may want to try, Julie, is a community health center. And you definitely go by your income if they have a dental program. And you're definitely not going to pay what you would pay to a private practice. So see if you have any community health centers near where you live in Utah.
Or even some dental
schools.
Do some preventive care. Mm-hmm. Like if you have a dental school in some sort, they will do preventive care that would like maybe clean and scrape your teeth and so forth.
Wonderful. And last, I just have a tip after transplant. When you travel, always have your medications in your carry-on.
Yes.
If you check your bag, just always have your meds on your carry-on. That's just a
tip.
Absolutely. I'm done. Thank you very much.
Oops, sorry.
Well, thank you for inviting us.
Yes, thank you, all three of you, so much for taking the time and giving such a comprehensive overview on the basics of transplant. I know all of our patients really enjoyed it and really appreciate it, and I do as well. So thank you again, and thank you all for joining today. Our next education call is slated for March 29th. And that will discuss living well on dialysis. So hopefully we'll see you then.